At this time, I'd like to hand it over to Susan Osborne.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our May County 100 County Director call. We're so glad to have you with us this morning. I think this morning I saw some of the best numbers about the pandemic that we've seen so far. Our daily rate was down this morning, positive rate to 4.2%. We still had 525 new cases since yesterday, but that is such an improvement from where we have been over the last year. As you all know, vaccinations is our focus now, as we have several campaigns going on right now. Your Spot, Your Shot, .nc.gov is a great place to refer your community members, your staff, anyone who still needs to find the best place to take their vaccine. We are at 52.7% of all of our adults over the age of 18 in North Carolina who have received at least one shot, one of their vaccines. So we still have a ways to go, but we have made progress. We appreciate our partners, and you have been our partner in this. We appreciate all you've done and all you continue to do to keep your communities safe. So we will get started this morning, and I just had a brief, as you can see, our agenda is up on the screen, but I inserted one quick item before we move into foster care visits. And I wanted to talk with you this morning about county MOU agreements. So next slide, please, Jay. So we did receive 99 counties who signed on the MOU performance management agreement with DHHS. We, and I'm not seeing that slide yet, Jay.
Yeah, it's lagging. I apologize.
That's all right. No problem. I just didn't want to get ahead of what was on the screen for folks to look at. So, as you know, we have paused performance measure, corrective actions, development plans, which is what we are calling them now, several times since we've started these agreements. We've paused them for natural disasters, when data was unavailable, and then we paused them last year at the beginning of the pandemic. As we continue to formalize our policy in this area, we have made the decision to establish some formal criteria for the practice of pausing or lifting those corrective actions and development plans. And guess what? Our number one criteria will be to evaluate a pause when all or parts of our state are under an emergency declaration, like we are now. Leadership at DHHS thus has made the decision that we will not be issuing any formal corrective actions or development plans related to MOU performance during this period of state fiscal year. As you remember, this MOU started effective January 1st of 2021, and it goes for 18 months through June 30th of 2022. So for all the months that we are under an emergency declaration, we will be pausing any corrective action or development plans. We will continue to monitor performance, share data concerns, provide technical assistance to you and your county during this time, but no corrective actions or development plans. As we build out this policy, we certainly welcome your input about additional criteria to consider for our policy as we go forward about, you know, when we pause. So I hope I hope this move lets you know that we are partners with you in this work and that we certainly understand the increases that you are seeing in your workload. We certainly know and are aware, just like us, that you are impacted by workforce issues as schools have been closed and folks have been quarantined. We also know that as we move into recovery, that you are the safety net for your communities and that more folks will enter your doors that have never been there before. So I think that's all, unless there are any questions. But again, we appreciate your partnership as we work together in this work and in the pandemic. So thank you. Jay, are there any questions?
I was just going to say, we don't have any questions at this time.
Okay, so I would like to turn this over to Rob, who wants to talk about how this decision impacts the dashboard.
Good morning, everyone. So as Susan mentioned, you know, with looking at the period of emergency declaration and not issuing corrective actions and development plans, we wanted to make sure that paired with our timeline on when we take this dashboard onto the public website, the public DHHS website. And we are looking at that timeline, but I think where we've landed at this point is that we will not push forward on taking the dashboard onto the public website until after the emergency declaration is lifted. Similar to, and just to keep it in alignment with the decision on corrective actions and development plans. But with that in mind, I do want to announce that hopefully by the end of next week, we will be publishing some revised versions of the dashboards. And some of you have seen and heard about this, and we did some focus groups and got feedback from the survey about the dashboard, and based some of this, the changes we've made based on your feedback. So I won't go into all the changes now. We will post that on the SharePoint site when the new dashboards are posted, so you can see exactly what's changed. But there's additional drill downs that are going to be added to the dashboards. There's some additional context measures. And then additionally, we are going to have an energy dashboard published for the first time. Currently, it'll just have the energy performance metric and no context measures, but soon after we'll be building in the context measures there as well. We also had heard feedback from a couple counties about how the rural versus urban layer of the dashboard didn't really have much common sense, and it was really tied to the OBSM classification scheme for what counties are rural and what counties are urban. We made the decision to change that to looking at the NC General Assembly or the legislature definition, which is greater than or equal to 250 persons per square mile. So we're also making that change to the dashboard, but there'll be a longer summary of what we're changing. And that leads us into our next topic. Which is, if you want to go to the next slide, and that is talking about foster care monthly visits. And I'll wait till that advances. We know with economic services data that, you know, as you complete an FNS application, it creates the data record that then becomes available for reporting and dashboarding. With child welfare, you know, you might be doing the work in the field, and a social worker will do the work in the field and then need to come, you know, at some point get that keyed into the system. So we want to talk a little bit about the cadence for foster care monthly visits and how that ties into the Rylands Law dashboard. If you could go to the next slide, please, Jay. And to start, I'll talk about what our current process is and some things we're going to do to improve the process on our end. So right now we're refreshing the child welfare and really all of the dashboards, but I'm going to specifically speak of the child welfare Rylan's Law dashboard now. We're refreshing it monthly with a 1 month lag, meaning that this month in May, we refresh the data through the end of all visits that happened through the end of March of 2001 that were keyed into the systems. We pull the data manually right now from CSDW and we load that into the dashboards. And we've been targeting that refresh by the end of the third full week of the month. Because it's a manual process, we haven't been able to really get it on the same date and time every month. We try to get it pretty close. And then we pull the data sometimes earlier. So before we go public with the dashboard, and really sooner than that, we want to establish a regular cadence for monthly visits to be keyed into the legacy system and the child welfare and NC Fast Child Welfare to make sure the dashboard is accurate. So Lisa, we'll go to the next slide and Lisa can talk about our plan for our new cadence. You're muted, I think, Lisa.
There we go. Before I go into this, I just want to say that one of the ways you have good data is even when you have a difficult system is everyone knows the rules around when the data needs to be put in there, when it's going to be pulled, and how you're going to keep it correct. And so I'm excited about this process because I think with all our data challenges, this is one of the things we can control. We can control knowing when people put data in or having rules around it, holding them accountable, and then having an adequate amount of time to make sure the data is actually in there, and then understanding when the data will be pulled. And so know that this is likely the cadence we'll use for all the child welfare data, but starting with the visits because they're so important. And what we want is we want the dashboard to be accurate, and we want the dashboard to show the visits that you're actually making, because we know every year when we turn this information into the feds, this is one of the outcomes that we meet for at least the past 4 years we've met it, and we like that, and we want the dashboard to show that. So here's the process that we think would work. Foster care monthly visits should be keyed into NC Fast or the legacy system by the 19th of each month. So by the 19th of the following month, your cadence with staff should be get them in there by the 19th of the following month. For the month before the previous month. So what we're looking for is by the 19th of May, all visits that were completed were through the end of March. Now, you think about when you give your staff directives, you don't want to give them the directive to key it 2 months later. You want them to have keyed it earlier than that because that's the deadline of when they need to be in there. But, each county can have their own rules around when they put them in there. But as long as it's understood that for the purpose of the dashboard, calculations of foster care visits are going to be derived from that information that is keyed by the 19th of the previous month. And so our HSBIA will pull the data on the 20th of the month or the next working day if the 20th falls on a weekend. And so the dashboard, we're going to pull it 2 months. This is a very much of a lag behind. So if staff enter this information by the end of the month, we're not even pulling it by, almost a month and a half later. And so the Rylan's Law dashboard will be refreshed on the 25th of the month or the previous working day if the 25th falls on a weekend or holiday. And we're looking at a way, Rob can talk a little bit more about this, to fully accommodate and refresh these dashboards and to have a way that they refresh overnight. But anyway, this gives you a cadence. It gives you plenty of time to make sure that your staff get them in there by the 19th of 1 month, knowing that if it's going to be published for May, it's going to be the visits you did in March. So you just need to remember this cadence so that your staff get that information in there, and you need to back up your own rules to know when does staff put it in there, when does somebody make sure it's correct, knowing that on the 19th we're going to run it, and on the 25th the dashboard is going to refresh. Rob, what would you add to that?
The only thing I'll add is that when we get this automated, part of the difficulty now is that if you go back and key a visit, if a visit is entered from like 6 months ago, my staff are having to go in and pull that data all the way back to as far back as any change was made manually. That won't be a problem when we automate, but the problem will become that the dashboard, of course, can change. If a visit is keyed for 6 months ago, the dashboard would automatically update and your measure and your percentage may change for months before. So we know that there's a trade-off there and definitely open to feedback. But once we automate it, we can go back as far as the dashboard goes and update with any changes that were made. But we just recognize the fact that for consistency, for the folks that are viewing the dashboard, we really want those measures to be accurate when they go in and look at it. When we finally do go live on the public website, we can certainly look at having a different cadence for the SharePoint versions of the dashboard and have it maybe be a lag there. So we refresh them on SharePoint a month or two before it gets refreshed or maybe at a more up-to-date and real-time way before it goes onto the public website, so you can see, oh, where am I at? So I think that'll be one of the benefits of automating. Really excited to have that work underway, and I think it'll open us up to being able to give you a lot more dashboards a lot quicker. So I think that's all I'd add. But looking at this this first quarter of fiscal year 22 to be able to start automating the refreshes and go at whatever refresh schedule we want, even if it was nightly on the SharePoint site.
Thank you. And just as a reminder, we're still the outcomes that are a part of the MOU, while we're not at a place, they are not going to take you to corrective action, even outside of the pandemic. This is the time for us to figure out how to get the data in there accurately. But just as a reminder, the outcomes that are in the MOUs for child welfare are the statewide data indicators, are the outcomes that the administrative children and families will look at the next round of the child and family services review. So thank you for all the hard work on this, and hopefully this is a process that will help you. And if you had any questions about it, the regional child welfare consultants have worked in this space for many years and can provide technical assistance if needed.
And we'll follow up with a Deer County Director letter that has more detail in the upcoming weeks.
So we do have a few questions if you guys are ready for those.
Okay,
question number one, what does HSBIA stand for?
That is the office that my team is a part of. It's the Human Services Business Information and Analytics Office.
If for some reason a county fails to key all visits by the 19th for the previous month and keys them after the 19th, will in future refreshes, will the information for that month be updated?
Yes, and that's actually once we automate the dashboard, we might even be able to have that update quicker, especially on the SharePoint site. So we're talking about two time frames. The now, when we're operating on that DSS Director SharePoint site that you and some of your leadership have access to, and then when we're on the public website, we're only going to refresh the dashboard on the public website once we go live there monthly. But we can have whatever cadence we want on the SharePoint site. We could refresh it nightly. And so yes, in future months, those months would refresh. But we really want to keep that data from changing. We don't want to have that data on the public website where a commissioner or someone from your delegation or whoever may look at it and then it change before they look at it the next time. We want to avoid that happening as much as possible. But yes, we're not going to just leave your measure alone if you don't meet the 19th deadline. It will update the next month, but you'll have that whole month where you're missing those visits.
When will that automation be put in place?
Looking at this, sometime I really want to get it done before the end of this fiscal year, but being realistic, because a lot of our business intelligence work and IT priorities are really focused on COVID and vaccine work. Trying to get prioritized in there may take a little time. I'm hoping by the end of this first quarter of this next fiscal year, but I think we may well overachieve in that department. So I don't want to stick a date on it, but absolutely for sure by the end of this first quarter of the next fiscal year.
Okay. And before I ask this last question, just as a reminder to everybody on the phone, you can type your questions into the question box, or you can raise your hand and we'll be happy to unmute you. In interest of time, there may be a time where we say we're going to answer questions at the end of the presentation. The last question, though, that I'm showing in our box regarding this topic is, I wanted to confirm that foster care visits completed by video conference are still allowed to be counted as face-to-face visits, and any expectations of when that requirement may be changing back to in-person visits?
You can. ACF gave flexibility to allow for virtual visits. We would recommend that when it's safe to move back to face-to-face, that you move back to face-to-face, and that you determine whether or not you can can you assure safety with a virtual visit, but it is certainly allowable. My belief is that there will be at some point, ACF will say they'll no longer allow that flexibility. Will be likely when we're, pretty soon, hopefully, when we're coming out of the pandemic. But that was a federal requirement, and I have not heard anything about that being rolled back. But I would just like to caution and make sure that there's considerations around what type of visit would ensure safety. I think we're at a place where you're seeing more staff vaccinated, more families vaccinated, and certainly could and should be moving away from virtual visits as we can.
Thank you. So, Rob, there was a question that came in after you and Susan talked about the MOUs and the dashboard. This question was, will the stop processing for SIP applications be implemented before Energy goes live on the dashboard?
Yeah, it's already been implemented. And we actually, we'll only be showing data from January 2021 forward. And actually had to go back and recalculate. There was a change request that was implemented at the end of 2020 regarding the stop processing for SIP applications. And part of the delay was getting that data cleanly pushed over to where we could report on it and then validated. So that is part of what will be in the Energy dashboard that we're publishing. It will be included.
Okay. All right. Looking to see if we have any additional questions. And I don't. So thank you both very much for sharing that with us. And for those of you in the audience, if you have any additional questions, you can reach out to Rob and Lisa, and I'm sure that they will help you get to those right answers. So thanks. Up next. Oh, yeah, Rob. Oh, they're saying bye. Bye, guys. So up next, Jay, if we could go ahead and move on to slide 8. Up next, we're just going to have some updates from Economic Services on the LEAP supplemental payments, the ARPA funds, and the LIWAP, and also PEBT. So Jay, if we can move on to slide 9. So on May 7th, we sent out information on how counties could begin to identify customers who had previously received a LEAP payment and would now be eligible for a one-time supplement payment. On May 18th, the Energy One-Time Supplement Report was made available in FastHelp. That one-time payment allows for a supplement of either $40.31, $53.75, or $67.19 based on the energy source that the applicant previously received. So this is just a reminder that payments will need to be issued and processed on your May service report. If the payments are not processed on your county's May service report, they will be deducted from your county's state fiscal year 2021-2022 allocations. So there were job aids regarding that one-time supplement that were placed on Fast Help. Those job aids are titled Energy Payment Request and Check Recording Process. So just wanted to remind you, and I see in the chat, can I repeat those amounts? So $40.31, $53.75, or $67.19, based on the there's a heating source that they received the previous LEAP payment. So for this one-time supplement payment, there is a total number of households of $129,573. The total amount that is being sent out for this one-time supplement is almost $7 million. So if you have any additional questions about that, please reach out to your representative or let us know, and we'll be happy to help you answer any questions that you have. All right, so if we can move on to the next slide, Jay. So on May 19th, Governor Cooper released his American Rescue Plan budget. And that budget included the initial plans for the use of the funds received through the American Rescue Plan Act, including funds for food and nutrition, low-income heating and energy, low-income household water assistance, and the TANF Pandemic Emergency Assistance Funds. The budget outlines the very early plans for the best use of these funds, but there is still a lot of work that needs to happen to ensure that the funds benefit all of North Carolinians, and your voice will matter. So on the next slides, I'm going to share any updates that we've received about these ARPA funds since our last meeting. And so, Jay, if we could go on to the next. Thank you. So on the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, or SNAP, we have received our allocation for North Carolina. For federal fiscal year 2021, we will be receiving $8.5 million. And in federal fiscal years 2022 and 2023, we will be receiving each of those years almost $15.5 million. The funds that are allocated each federal fiscal year must be allocated by September 30th of that year and then spent within 120 days following that. So in the documents that we've received so far, they outline the federal administrative priorities that they'd like to see be used, these funds be used for. They include investments in technology to improve client access to benefits, including online applications, benefit management tools, text messaging, and ensuring all client access is mobile enabled. Expanding call center capacity to reduce call center wait times, making investments in employees and infrastructure to provide the necessary technology and training in order to modernize customer service delivery, exploring opportunities to improve service delivery and access to vulnerable populations that may be disproportionately impacted by remote operations, language barriers, fear of government services, and a lack of access to technology, improvements to reporting systems to ensure timely and reliable information is provided to our Federal Office of Food and Nutrition Services, Congress, and stakeholders on program outcomes and activities, including major system changes, and to revise the SNAP web pages, instructions, and guidance to ensure program information is easy to find, clear, concise, and provided in the required languages. So you might have caught that we have just received notice that we have $8.5 million that needs to be spent before the end of federal fiscal year, September 30th. And it's a great problem to have to to think about how to best utilize those dollars. So stay tuned to hear more about our thoughts, and we will be reaching out also to get your thoughts on the best way to use these funds to help everyone in North Carolina. So if we could go to the next slide. So the Low Income Housing Water Assistance Program, or the LIHWAP, we've received some additional information about this since our last call. We've learned that the federal financial participation rate is 100%, and there will be no program cost share or matching required. All of the funds will have to be obligated by September 30th, 2023, but they will roll over each year. It will be modeled after our LIHEAP program, and in North Carolina, our procedures likely will closely follow our SIP procedures. And the requirements that we've received from the federal government are to ensure that low-income households have access to safe and clean drinking water and wastewater services, and to provide assistance to low-income households that pay a high proportion of their income for drinking water and wastewater services. Now, these funds will go directly to the owners or operators of public water systems or treatment works to reduce the arrearages of our customers and also reduce the rates that have been charged. So there is a website here at the bottom of the screen that you can follow along to see all of the most updated information regarding the LIHWAP program. And Jay, if we could go to the next slide. On that website, you'll see that there is a webinar coming up on June 3rd to talk more about the use of the funds and the administrative costs associated with LIHWAP. We are still awaiting notification of how much North Carolina will be receiving in LIHWAP payments. We were told to expect it by the end of May. We haven't received it just yet, so hopefully it'll come in the next couple of days, so we'll know how much money we will be receiving. So Jay, if we could go to the next slide. So thought we'd give you a quick update on PEBT. And Jay, if we could go ahead and skip to the next one. So I'm gonna just do some quick reminders about PEBT and talk about the eligibility for summer of 2021 PEBT, the timeline for that issuance. Sorry, our ongoing public awareness campaign and the resources that we have for the partners, and then we'll be ready to take some questions. So Jay, on our next slide. So as you all know, we started PEBT back in March of 2020, and we've had three different releases of PEBT for students K through 12. We had the March spring issuance, we had a fall, August, September issuance, and then we've had the entire school year of 2020-2021. Since March of 2020, we have sent out over $1 billion in PEBT benefits. In fact, I just got an updated number yesterday, and I think it's over $1.1 billion. We've served over 1 million students so far since March of 2020. Last week, our first payments went out for our PEBT for children under 6. And those payments that went out last week were for October through June of 2021. And we've sent out so far over $121 million for 232,000 children. Coming up next is our summer PEBT benefits. We have submitted our plan, and our plan has been approved to issue a single standard benefit amount to all students and children under 6 of $375 to cover the summer period of June through August. The way that these students will be identified, if we can go to the next slide. For students to be eligible for summer PEBT, they have to have met one of the following criteria. They either had to be eligible to receive free or reduced price meals through the National School Lunch Program as of May of 2021, or they could become eligible for free or reduced price meals at any time during the summer. This will include students who graduated this year. We will be using the data that we received from the Department of Public Instructions in May to do the list of all of the students who will receive that one-time benefit payment of $375. For children under the age of 6 to be eligible, they have to have received FNS benefits as of May 2021, or they become eligible for FNS benefits at any time during the covered summer period. So the first issuance of summer PEBT will be in July for $375, and it will be for the entire amount, June through August. And then there will be a catch up in September for any students or children under the age of 6 who became eligible over that summer period, and they will get their summer period amount of $375 in September. So if we can go to the next slide. So this is just the timeline of how our benefits are going out right now. As you know, for the school year, our April benefits will get paid out in May. So for the school month of April, those payments are going out this month. They started last week as well. Benefits for May will go out in June for both students and children under the age of 6. Benefits for June will go out in July. And so that would be for any students who, students or children under 6 in the month of June who are still in school in June will get a June benefit paid out in July. Just so you know, students whose school year ended in the month of May will not be eligible for June 2021 school year benefits. For the summer, all children eligible as of the last month of the school year will get June through August and July of 2021. And then, like I mentioned, for any that become eligible over the summer period, will get theirs in September of 2021. So can we go to the next slide, Jay? So there is an ongoing public awareness campaign for PEBT, and we have started doing the public awareness for children under 6. We started that in May, and we sent out our toolkits to all the counties in May as well. And all of our web pages and frequently asked questions have been updated. Social media messages go out continuously on our Facebook page, Twitter, and Instagram, talking about PEBT benefits. Our intention is to announce the summer PEBT benefits next week. There will be a press release issued in either Wednesday or Thursday of next week, and you will be getting a copy of that press release so that you have that available to you. And then we will be sending out the toolkits, though, in July, so closer to that release. The decision was made to go ahead and issue a press release next week so that families whose students are in school are aware that they will indeed get benefits for the summer months. Also to help remind them not to throw away their PEBT cards, since more money will be coming on it. And third, to assist the schools who may be getting a lot of questions from families. Also noted that getting summer PEBT will not prohibit them from receiving any other summer lunch meal programs that are offered. So they can still receive PEBT and still be eligible for any other summer meal programs. So if we could go to this next slide. So just a reminder, PEBT benefits for the month of May will be issued in June. Final round of ongoing benefits for school year 2020-2021 will be for the month of June and issued in July, and that will overlap with the first month of summer PEBT eligibility. So families will actually receive two PEBT payments in the month of July, one for the last issuance of the school year and one for the summer. We are still waiting on guidance for the 21-22 school year. We haven't received guidance about that yet. What we really need from you is to encourage families to keep their current PEBT card so that they can continue to receive benefits through the summer month. Continue to share updated PEBT information provided by DHHS with your team, as well as students and families. And then watch out for updated materials on our website or other online resources so that you can share that information with your customers as well. So I'm going to just take a look and see if we have any questions. That was a lot to cover. So I see this question on the one-time LEAP payment. If there is an outstanding ticket that prevents the county from issuing payments due to a job aid not working, what will be the course of action and will that fall on the county? So Richard, would you mind, or Rob, either one of you, mind answering that question?
So just budgetarily speaking, Carla, you know, we'll have to close out the fiscal year and, you know, funds will be available in the current fiscal year as they are currently budgeted and applied, right? If it gets into a situation of rolling into a next time frame, then it would come out into the next year, budget year.
Okay, thank you. Next question was, is there a target date for when the LIWAP program will start? It's a great question. So we anticipate receiving our funding award notice by the end of May, but we do not anticipate receiving final instructions about the LIWAP program until probably July or August. So I cannot imagine that the program will start anytime before September. We will have a very quick turnaround to getting it set up once we've gotten all of the final instructions, but hope to have a lot more information about that by our call next month on what to expect on the timing of that. So just a comment, call centers are a great investment for improving customer service. Recommend using funds to strengthen call centers already in existence in counties to start new call centers in other interested counties. Thank you for that, Glenn. Definitely we'll keep that in consideration. So is the $375 per child or per household? Great question, Wanda. That is per child, $375 per child, not per household. If a child was a senior and finished school in December, but doesn't graduate until May, will they receive the PEBT benefit for the summer? That's a great question. It will be based on the school calendar and the student calendar that they send. And so if that student is not attending school in May, they would not receive the summer PEBT benefits. We will be using the record sent by the school in the month of May. It's a great question. Oh, on slide 19, what does NSLP stand for? NSLP stands for the National school lunch program. Next question, is a LIWOP plan to be an EPASS? If I have any control over that, the answer to that is yes. And so we will have a lot of work to do programming wise to get that, but that is definitely the goal. Will these slides be available for printing after the call? Yes. Gwen will be sending out this PowerPoint following this this meeting so that you all can have it to print. Administrative funding for water. Jan, I'm not sure what the question is, so if you might want, there, it's 100% FFP, if that's what you're asking. And there's no requirement for a county share, but if you have additional questions, if you'd email me, I'd be happy to respond. Oh, I see. So Jeff, can you provide more information on the administrative funding related to LIWOP? Will it be a set amount of funding for admin as it is with SIP and LEAP, or will it be an uncapped funding source? That's a great question. There are still a lot of things that have to be worked out as we get more guidance and we're developing our guidance. So I don't have an answer to that question yet. If the card cannot be used by a foster child because they are in, I'm not sure what PRTF is, or congregate care, what do we do with the fund or the card or the funds? So I'm assuming you're saying that there's a PEBT card and the foster care cannot use it because they're in PRTF or in congregate care. What do we do with the Carter funds? Brian, if you wouldn't mind reaching out to to Allison Smith, and we can work on getting an answer for you on that question. That would be great.
Hey, Carla?
Yes. Oh, Bob, you know the answer. There you go.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I mean, this has typically been a county decision because you're going to have better understanding of the circumstances. If the benefits cannot be used to benefit the child at the time because of the placement that the child is in, my recommendation, it would be to hold the card until there is a caretaker that could use the cards to benefit the child, and that's typically what we've heard of counties doing in those circumstances. But ultimately we want the benefits to benefit the child with purchases of food. And if that can't happen because of a certain living arrangement type, then holding until there is a living arrangement type that it can happen in would be my recommendation. Just knowing that the benefits would be expunged if there's inactivity for, and I believe it's changing from 365 days to, I can't remember what, 274 days or something like that. So just keep that in mind that, you know, if there's no activity on the card at all, eventually the benefits would be expunged.
And Carla, this is Susan. I agree with 100% with Rob's answer. It's just like, you know, if a child is moving to a new foster home or in the process of returning home, you might hold the card. So that is the county's decision, and the criteria is used for the benefit of the child in the child's best interest.
Thank you both. Another question that came in is, if the school year ends in May but the school offers summer school, how will students be determined for eligibility in those summer school settings? So attending summer school does not affect this, as long as the school records show that they were a student and they were eligible for PEBT in May, they will still receive summer PEBT benefits even if they're in summer school. There's no impact on that. And thank you guys for giving me that definition of PRTF. So there's a couple of comments about LIWAP. I will tell you that there has been no policy set yet on LIWAP, and so that will be coming as we learn more. So a lot of your questions, we just don't have an answer to yet because there is no policy set. So we will make sure that we keep you in the loop on that. There was a question, do these cards or benefits expire? These benefits will expire 1 year following the last usage of those benefits. And so they do expire, or expunge is the right word, not expire. They get expunged 1 year after there's been no activity on that card.
And keep in mind, Carla,
and so Annie, that may change, you're right. So right now it's at 365 days. Under the farm bill, there was a change to benefits expunging from 365 days to 274 days. We are still working on our policy of exactly when that will go into effect. And we'll talk more about that as we get further clarification from USDA on that expungement. But right now it's 365 days, but Rob is exactly right. That could change in October of 2021. We'll keep you guys updated on that. All right. I don't see any other questions in the chat box. Other than there's one in here, just so you know, Bobby Williams, we'll reach out to you and work with you on that directly. Thank you all for all those questions. And I just want to check with Jay to see if Melanie is here. So up next, in our agenda, we have Melanie Bush, who is here to give us an update on Medicaid managed care. So Melanie, welcome.
Thanks, Carla. Good morning, everyone. My name is Melanie Bush. I am Chief Administration Officer here at North Carolina Medicaid. I'm also joined by Deborah Farrington, who is our Chief of Staff at North Carolina Medicaid. And we're here to present a Medicaid managed care update. We are just over a month away from the launch of Medicaid managed care. And so we thought we would present the results of our biggest milestone to date. So next slide. As many of you are aware, we completed auto enrollment this past weekend. And when we have those numbers, we will of course share them with the counties in terms of the number of beneficiaries and the plans that they were enrolled in. But just to sort of level set, we have 2.5 million members in Medicaid beneficiaries. Of that 2.5 million, 1.6 must enroll in managed care by July 1. 1.4 million members have either made a selection or were auto-enrolled this past weekend. The other remaining 166,000 are up for redetermination between now and July 1st. So we closed open enrollment on Friday of last week, and just over 200,000 beneficiaries made a plan selection. And then the remaining members went through our algorithm and were auto-enrolled into a health plan. Those that are up for recertification, they will be auto-enrolled when their recertification is complete, and then they will have a 90-day choice period, just like all of our other beneficiaries. Starting from July 1st until September 30th, beneficiaries can change plans without cause for any reason. Next slide. So after our auto-enrollment, process was really based on a couple of different factors: what health plans were available, where that beneficiary lived, and whether or not they had a prior primary care provider, and then family member assignments. So 95% of our Medicaid beneficiaries do have a prior PCP. Of those, After auto enrollment, 97% of those beneficiaries are enrolled in a health plan that contains their PCP. So we're hoping that this will ensure continuity of care. The beneficiaries are able to select their PCP. The health plans will do auto assignment of PCPs if they did not select one, and they will use prior PCP as a factor. Like I said, just over 200,000 made a selection. So that was about 15% of our mandatory members made an active selection of their health plan, and then 85% were auto enrolled. Next slide. So I wanted to let the counties know that confirmation notices of this auto enrollment will start going out today and will continue next week. There is a sample of the confirmation notice in the county playbook, and I've listed that here and included a screenshot. But essentially, the confirmation notice will tell them that, you know, they've either selected a plan or one has been selected for them. It tells them what that plan is, and it tells them that they can change their plan until September 30th of 2021 and the process for doing that. So I wanted folks to be aware that we are expecting about 120,000 notices a day, starting today, tomorrow, Friday, and next week. And then I think in Thursday and Friday of next week, there'll be about 50,000 going out a day. And so I wanted folks to be aware you may get a call. And so next, I think I will turn it over to Deborah to provide other updates. Deborah?
Thank you, Melanie. And good morning, everybody. As Melanie mentioned, I'm Deborah Farrington with North Carolina Medicaid. I'm the chief of staff. And I'll go to the next slide. I think we're going to cover some information about upcoming milestones. We have communicated prior that on June 1st, individuals who are enrolled in a health plan can begin scheduling non-emergency medical transportation appointments with that health plan broker. You know that there are two brokers who are contracted with the health plan, One Call and Motive Care. So they will begin scheduling appointments for Medicaid mandatory enrolled beneficiaries starting on June 1st. June 12th is the date by which all beneficiaries who will be enrolled in a health plan July 1st should have received their member information. That includes the welcome packet from the health plan and their member ID card. We go live on July 1st. We have had what we consider a very successful auto enrollment, and I think that's one of the key milestones in our successful launch of managed care. And so we don't anticipate at this time there are any known factors that would prevent us from going live on July 1st. August 30th is the last date by which health plans will pay claims and authorize services for Medicaid enrolled out-of-network providers equal to that of in-network providers. And so we have created this provision 60 days after we began managed care that providers can get paid the same rate if they're out of network as if they were in net with a health plan. So that date is August 30th, 2021. September 29th is the last date by which the health plans must honor existing or active prior authorizations, which have been on file with us, or they're required to honor the authorization until the end of the authorization period, whichever comes first. And then, as Melanie mentioned earlier, September 30th ends the choice period for beneficiaries if they want to change the health plan that they selected or to which they were assigned. Next slide. We have a number of individuals who will be transitioning to managed care who will, as I mentioned before, have their NEMT trips coordinated by Motive Care or One Call. We have been working with the health plans over the last couple of months to increase the number of providers that they have available. And the next couple of charts outline for you some information that was sent, I think, in the county update that came out from Liz O'Dell or our member team. But this summary chart shows the number of public and private providers who are contracted with a health plan. This is for both Motive Care and One Call. So there are a total of 70 public providers, about 342 private providers who are available to provide NEMT transportation. The next slide, I think, is a summary for Motive Care. And it does list their public and private providers. I will say that both One Call and Motive Care are still in active negotiations and conversations with primarily public transit providers, although they can bring on any provider. The department has placed a good bit of emphasis on they're trying to get to a contract with our public transit authorities. Those public transit providers have provided millions of rides to beneficiaries. And so we want to make sure that to the greatest extent possible, they remain a part of the network. The next slide, I think, provides the numbers for One Call. And I think that, again, you have this information in the information update to DSSs this week. And I think that was our last slide. And we are, if time permits, available for questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Melanie and Deborah. We did have just a couple of questions. Try to get through these. Let me get to the beginning. So beneficiaries were auto-enrolled with PHPS, but the PCP was not chosen. When will the PCPs be assigned to the beneficiaries?
So that's a very timely question. I believe that process starts today. The PHPs will assign the beneficiaries their PCP, again, taking into account historic PCP claims information. And then once that selection process happens over the next couple of days, then the PHPs will start mailing out welcome packets to the beneficiaries that include their cards and with their PCP listed on that card.
Great. So can counties get a report with the names, et cetera, of the Medicaid recipients that are not mandatory?
I will have to take that back. For beneficiaries that are mandatory after auto enrollment, they should have a health plan listed with their information in NC Tracks. And for beneficiaries that are not mandatory, they will not have a health plan listed. We can certainly pull the numbers. I would have to think about and get guidance on the actual names for the counties. But we did send out a report to the counties several weeks ago listing who's mandatory, the number count of who's mandatory and who's not. But I understand this is a request for actual names. So I'll take that back, Carla. Sorry.
Okay, no problem. When will counties be expected to be notified of their data related to enrollment?
We're hoping to get that out as soon as possible. I believe that we are waiting on finalization of, and our staff is reviewing those numbers, and then we will share them and break them down by county. Hopefully by Monday, in the Monday communication, we can send that out.
And so how are counties supposed to respond whenever they get calls starting next week from individuals coordinating NEMT that must now go through the broker?
So if it's for NEMT prior to July 1, the county should still coordinate that. It is, if it is for other services after July 1, I would, and the beneficiary is enrolled with a health plan, then they need to be directed back to their health plan.
Okay, let me see if I have any others. One more, a couple more questions. For NEMT, is DSS still responsible for completing NEMT yearly assessments with beneficiaries?
Yes, for their beneficiaries that they will continue to serve, they are responsible for completing that. Yes.
Okay. Will they be able to get a list of NEMT providers?
A list of NEMT providers, I guess I would need more context about. For the county should know their own NEMT providers. If they're looking for a list of NEMT providers that are contracted with the health plans, I believe we've gotten that request. Deborah?
I do think we have gotten that request and have been working on it. So yeah, I need to follow up, Melanie, because I'm not sure of the status of that list. I will say that we have been working with the health plans and the transportation brokers to complete contracts by a certain date, just because we had asked them to contract with a certain number of public transit providers. And so we may be waiting to get to the end of that reporting period, which I think is coming up pretty close to early June, to provide that detail to the counties.
So there were several other questions in the question box, but in the interest of time, what I'd love to do is send those questions to Melanie and Deborah, and ask that you respond to those people directly. Would that be okay?
That'd be perfect. Thank you.
Perfect. All right. Thank you both so much for joining us today and sharing all that. Up next, we have Elizabeth Everett, who is going to be giving us some updates on DCDEE. So Elizabeth, are you with us?
Yes, good morning. Hey, Carla.
Good morning.
Are you able to hear me? Can you hear me?
In and out, though.
Okay. So good morning, everybody. This is Elizabeth Everett. I'm the Assistant Director of the Subsidy Services Section with the Division of Child Development and Early Education. Just wanted to give you a few updates this morning. As always, we had a spending update for services last month. As a statewide spending coefficient, we are at 100.02%. So we are in a good place, as we are in our last month to end the spending of this fiscal year. We will be looking at counties who are over and underspending, and we'll be able to make adjustments if needed to basically get everyone in a good place, so that everyone is above the 92% spending coefficient, so that does not have a negative, that 92% requirement does not have a negative impact on allocations as we move forward into the next fiscal year. We are, of course, awaiting we have the governor's budget, but we, of course, are awaiting the final budget for next fiscal year to know where to allocate those dollars. So there'll definitely be more to come on that. So that's kind of where we are with spending. I also wanted to touch on the additional federal dollars that we have received. In particular, we have the Coronavirus Response and Relief Supplemental Appropriations Act, those funds, the CRRSA. And just to give some updates about what the division is doing around those dollars, that legislation, Session Law 2021-3, it gave us some pretty specific guidance on how to spend the almost $336 million in non-recurring funds that was allocated to us. It did, the legislation did advise us to use part of those funds to cover parent fees for the remainder of the fiscal year. We are of course doing that. We have also agreed to continue to pay parent fees through the service month of October of 2021. It's possible that we may extend that further, but at this point, that's what we are able to commit to, and we'll of course reassess as we get closer to October about whether or not we can extend that support for families. As we've discussed, I believe previously, but I'll go over it. You probably have noticed that the parent fee amounts, they are coming out of allocations right now. The amount of parent fees that for your individual county has been incorporated into the expenditure report. There is a separate place for that, so you can see how much of what went out of your allocation was for parent fees. The reason we are doing it that way is so that we want to make sure that we expend our regular CCDF allocation, just our regular subsidy dollars. It's very important that we expend as much of those dollars as we possibly can. And so that's why the parent fees come out of your allocation. But then if there's any overage that happens, then that's where we basically are able to backfill with the federal dollars that we've received. So you're not hindered to add children, you know, if your spending allows for that minus the parent fee expenses. And we'll continue to kind of go in that manner with the parent fees, just because, again, it's so important that we make sure that we are expending our regular CCDF dollars for our regular subsidy. And so if you have specific questions about your county, and your spending, of course, we are always here for conversation. We can do conference calls or whatnot. Let your TA consultant know, and that he or she can definitely grab in budget as well as myself if needed to talk about specific county situations or questions. So also with the CRRSA, the legislation also gave us guidance that we could use these funds on cleaning and sanitation needs for childcare providers, and various PPE. So there is PPE being provided to, we're continuing to provide PPE to childcare providers. We have been able to do that in the past as well, and we're continuing that. Also, our operational grants for childcare providers, we are continuing those that are going out. Those operational grants are available for all licensed childcare providers and regulated providers, not just the 3, 4, and 5, but we are continuing that. And then the legislation also instructed us that we could use some of the funds for an early childhood education, learning loss, and summer enrichment activities. And so the division has created we're calling it the NC Pre-K Summer Learning Program. Basically, it is, we are prioritizing children, 4-year-olds who are already currently enrolled in NC Pre-K to be able to have, you know, extended classroom time during the summer. We are still in the process of working with our partners across the state to really get the specifics of which communities are going to participate, which partnerships, which school systems, which classrooms, that type of thing. So we're also working on the payment structure for that. It'll be done through a contract process, just like NC Pre-K is, or the regular NC Pre-K program is. We will use our Salesforce portal to collect data on the individual classrooms as well as the individual children that participate. So you definitely will see more information coming about this. We're very much in the final stages of planning at this point, but you will see that there are three options for length of the programs. They can be 4 weeks, 5 weeks, or 6 weeks. We are paying a set dollar amount to the classrooms based on the length of time. And they will get that money in advance. So basically they're able to pay their teachers and staff to actually get the program going. And also, because of course, this is not something that they have budgeted already, of course. We also will be providing a $2,500 additional payment or on top of the set payment for the length of their classroom that they can use for supplies. We will be working very closely with our local partnerships and the local agencies who we contract with for NC Pre-K to assist the providers to do monitoring, ensure that each classroom has all of the requirements. And of course, our local partners will make those payments to the individual providers. So I'm excited to get that going. Priority for children, as I mentioned earlier, children currently enrolled at NC Pre-K will be first priority for this program. Second priority for this program will be children who are NC Pre-K eligible. And then if there are, after those two categories have been served, if there are additional slots in classrooms to that are still vacant, then any four-year-old who a family who feels that their child could benefit from it would be able to join. Of course, there's no cost to families for this program. So for impact on subsidy, the regular subsidy, so you may have some four-year-olds who participate in this program during the summer who may just need wrap services. Maybe they're typically full-time on subsidy in the summer, but they go to to one of these programs and they just need the before and after care. So I just wanted to make sure that everyone was aware. So if families report that there is a change in their plan of care because their child is attending one of these programs for part of the summer, you would be aware of what we're talking about. Of course, if you have any questions about that as it comes up, definitely reach out to the division, reach out to your TA consultant if you have questions or need additional guidance. So we're excited to get that going. Right now, we know the guidance that has been provided to the local partnership or the local agencies allows the programs to basically begin as of June 1, depending on various school systems and when their individual schools end within the different districts. Right now, we know our first classroom is going to start on June 7th. And again, we're looking, this is a summer program, so we'll see all of these programs wrap up, mid-August, as so that the children are not in this program at the time that school starts. We don't want it overlapping with any school schedules. So that is really how we are focusing on spending the CRRSA funds that we have received. We do have an allocation from the ARPA funds. We know from the ARPA funds, a good portion of the funds that we receive, probably around $805 million of those funds will go towards a child care stabilization grant program. That direction for that and guidance is actually coming from our federal partners. This will be a grant program that is available in all states. So the feds are giving us, particular requirements around the stabilization grants. And then, of course, we'll implement it, for North Carolina, as every other state will do with their allocation. So this will be, these stabilization grants will be considerably larger dollar amounts than what we have been providing in the operational grants thus far. And providers will have to go through an application process for these stabilization grants. And there are some restrictions on how the dollars can be spent once they are given to a provider. There will be eligibility criteria for our providers. But what we do know is that all of our providers who are eligible to receive subsidy within North Carolina, they will be eligible for a stabilization grant. If they're eligible for subsidy, they basically automatically meet the criteria for the stabilization grants. The grants will be available to cover fixed cost, tuition reduction for any low-income families that they may be serving, and cost to stabilize and build quality staffing. So we are in the kind of early planning phases on what the application process will be for this, and basically getting a formula worked out so that we will be able to, you know, calculate the appropriate amount of the grants once we are able to receive applications. So that's going to be a large part of our ARPA funds. We are also looking at other ways to spend those funds, as well as looking at what has been included in the governor's budget. We don't have final decisions. Again, like I said earlier, we're definitely still planning, but we are looking at ways that we could potentially expand access to child care subsidies. Also looking at expanding access to affordable and high quality infant toddler care, as well as expanding access to NC pre-K. And also looking at business support for child care facilities, as well as building the supply of family child care homes. So a lot of different areas that we're looking into. I don't have details right now. I definitely will, as we progress and get some final decisions in place, definitely we'll share more details. But those are some of the things that we are looking at this point as ways to spend these dollars. Two last things that I just wanted to, one, bring your attention to, and the other, just to make you aware of, our 90-day transition policy. I know I've talked about that before, in that we are changing that right now. Basically, 90-day transition is offered to families when they are experiencing a temporary change. And our policy does allow for families to be terminated, their services to be terminated prior to the end of their 12-month eligibility period, if they do not have a need for care after that 90-day transition. North Carolina did receive a finding when we were audited by or monitored by OCC last July, because of the fact that we have terminated families prior to the end of their 12-month certification period because of our 90-day transition policy. So we're adjusting that so that basically our 90-day transition would only be offered to families when they have a non-temporary change in their need for care. Temporary changes such as switching jobs, maternity leave, breaks in education for holidays or summers, those are considered temporary changes and should not have an impact on the certification period. So the policy will be coming out. I'm asking for a little bit more guidance and some clarification around how to handle recertifications, specifically if a mother is on maternity leave at the time of recertification. I am asking our federal partners for a little bit more guidance and direction there. So hopefully I will receive that guidance very soon and be able to get that policy out, but just wanted to give that reminder to keep it on your radar. Until that policy comes out, yes.
I was just gonna say we're close to time, so just wanted to give you a heads up.
Sure, not a problem. I was just to conclude that if in the meantime, until that policy changes, please continue to follow the current policy around 90-day transition. Don't change any of your procedures and practices at this time. And that really wraps it up for me, unless there are any questions.
I do apologize for that interruption, though. I thought you were pausing to end. So I apologize for that interruption, Elizabeth. The only one question is, will you ensure that Smart Start allocations are also spent?
Yes, of course. For Smart Start allocations, I'm thinking that question is in reference to as we get to the end of the fiscal year. If you are underspending in Smart Start, you definitely need to look at doing transfer obligations to get as many children into the Smart Start fund as possible, because yes, we want to ensure that Smart Start allocations are expended. So yeah, okay. And like I said, more specific questions about counties, definitely reach out and let us know. Thank you, Carla.
Thank you, Elizabeth. It gets hard when we can't see each other, so apologize again for stepping over you, but thank you for that update, Elizabeth. And for those of you on the call, if you have questions, please reach out directly to Elizabeth. We're going to go ahead and move on down our agenda. Up next, we have Ashley Arrington, who is going to give us some information about NCFAS training and certification program. Ashley?
Thank you, Carla. Again, my name is Ashley Arrington. I also work in the HSBIA department as the Human Service Training Support Manager. And I wanted to do some updates and kind of keep moving forward on our information around the NCFAS training and certification program. Next slide, Jay. All right, so where are we right now? We are actually with our group two counties going in. We now have close to a quarter of the state now somehow involved in this process. So I've highlighted those counties with their color codes. We knew that with group two, their new staff would be entering in May 1st. And so those folks have started. A number of them already have some new staff that have either been hired or moved into new programs, and we've really enjoyed getting to know a lot of their champions, as well as talking with them about their workers and watching their progress. Next slide. So at this point, all of Group 1, which were our pilot counties, they are completely enrolled at this point, all of their staff, new and existing. And are moving forward. They began their Medicaid program for their existing workers this past month. Our group two counties, again, have started their new staff into the certification program. Starting in June, their existing workers for childcare, Work First, refugee, and their admin folks. So the folks who are not taking eligibility decisions, but do take actions in the system. That'll be followed in July by their SA and energy existing workers, FNS in August, and Medicaid in September. Next slide. All right, so these are just the current numbers. I try to update these when we do this call. And so currently we have 257 users that are in progress. 18 of those are new workers across multiple programs, and 239 are existing workers. We did see a little bit of a spike once we added some of the group two for the new workers. And then with our completion rate, we saw one of our highest bumps in numbers, with 146 additional workers certified in NCFAS core functions. And then 107 have already completed all of the level one training requirements. So that was an addition of 56. So we expected to see a bump once the pilot groups had all of their staff in. For the core functions piece, and that trend has held true. 81% of our workers have passed on the first attempt. That's actually an improvement by about 10% from last month. And our average score is an 83% on that core functions, 84% of the workers have passed on their first attempt. I usually put a little note in here afterwards just to let folks know that currently we still have no staff who have failed certification at this point. Less than 1% take more than 2 attempts to meet the 70% requirement. So while we do have some folks who do have to take a second attempt, we have not had very many make it to a third attempt. So that's good progress, and we appreciate the hard work that the counties and your staff are doing. Next slide. So we wanted to kind of talk through some updates and current issues that we've had or have experienced in the last month. We did hold our Group 2 implementation calls in April. We really enjoyed getting to know our Group 2 counties, and we're looking forward to our Group 3s coming. We also made additional reporting available to the champions and allowed them to be able to generate the reports that they also would like to see information on. As far as the training attempts and stats on their individual counties. We did have an inadvertent enrollment of existing workers in Group 2 in May. There was a setting change that we were not aware of when we did an update, and we fixed that the same day and notified those users that they were enrolled inadvertently and that they were not due to start. So we did get that fixed the same day, and I appreciate the counties who reached out and let us know that. We also have scheduled for the next several months all of our ongoing and implementation check-in calls, and we'll be releasing that schedule shortly. Next slide. All right, so what is next? We have our Group 1s. At this point, they are completely enrolled, and so the only things that we are going to see from them are going to be any new hires or staff that they move to a new program. So they are completely in. If you're in a Group 1 county, we want to make sure that your champions and your POCs are reviewing their user reports, keeping those staff numbers updated so that you're not held accountable for workers who don't work for you. Group 2, again, their staff, new staff should automatically enroll as soon as they create their Learning Gateway profile. That time clock will start, and then their first round of existing staff, like we talked about earlier, we'll be going in June 1. They will automatically be enrolled. They'll see it on their required learning. And then make sure that you have a certification champion on file so that you get those ongoing communications. We do have a few that have not identified a champion for certification. So you need to do that if you've not done it. Next slide. All right, and then Group 3 is coming on, and I will pop that up here in just a minute as to who all's in Group 3. But this is good information. We'll be sending this out with a Dear County Director letter. You all will need to make sure that you've identified your certification champion. You can send that to me. I will work to get that on our communication list as well as in the Learning Gateway with the Learning Gateway Administrator. She has a group that she includes that with to give them access to all the ins and outs. We have 2 calls set up currently for implementation purposes. Those are on June 4th and June 10th. The June 4th one is a morning one, 10 to 11:30, and June 10th is an afternoon, 2 to 3:30. And then we've been doing these final check-in calls right before a group goes live just to kind of touch base, see if there's any outstanding issues that the counties are having. This has served us well, and so we're going to continue to do that with our other groups. So that call will be June 28th from 9:30 to 10:30, and it just allows us to kind of ease any fears or concerns kind of at the last minute. The last couple of things that Group 3 needs to make sure they're doing, make sure your staff have updated their profiles in Learning Gateway because that drives their enrollment. And then your LGPOCs or Certification Champion needs to run your user report in the Learning Gateway and mark any outdated users that need to be archived and send that to the LG FastHelp email so that the Learning Gateway Administrator can archive them. Okay, next slide. All right, so just kind of laying this out again, just to make sure folks are still in the loop. The pilots are in 100% and Group 2 began in May. In June, we know Group 2's existings will start. Now that we've ironed out some of the issues with the the enrollment where we had that setting update. We are back on track for group three to begin in July, group four in August, and group five in September, so that by the time we get to the new year, everyone is enrolled. So we're looking forward to that. It's been a long road to get here. Groups four and five, just so that you guys are aware, we will be sending out in that Dare County Director letter all of the implementation and check-in calls for your group as well. Those have already been created, so you can go ahead and start identifying folks and get that information to us. Next slide. And so this is just a reminder again of our groups. They are alphabetized by group. And so again, group two, many of you have gotten involved and jumped in, and we greatly appreciate that. And then group three, we're looking forward to starting to have those conversations with you all. Again, we've tried to make this as easy as a process as possible so that you guys don't have to do as much on the front end to prepare other than the Learning Gateway profile. So just giving that heads up as we continue to move forward. Next slide. So that's where we are currently. I will say that the Learning Gateway administrator intends to release some trainings in the next month around some navigation pieces that you guys have given feedback on during this process, around with the supervisor dashboards and things of that nature. And so we recognize that this is a great opportunity for you all to engage with the Learning Gateway platform. And we want to make that a easy transition and improve that experience for you all. Are there any questions?
Just one so far, Ashley. Should group three have received information already?
No, they are beginning in July. We will start all of their calls and get them set up in June. And that Dare County Director letter should be going out either later today or by the end of this week.
Great. Well, let's see, one more. Can you share the role and responsibilities of the LGPOC?
Yeah, so you can have my understanding from, and that again, that's not underneath us, but the communication that the Learning Gateway administrator sent out back some time ago, I guess it was in October and again in December, is that you are allowed, each county is allowed four POCs for Learning Gateway, and that needs to include folks on your child welfare side as well, because they are also in the Learning Gateway. And what that allows is for them to have access to all the user reports, all the training reports on your county for compliance purposes and whatnot. So, you know, if you've got an IBE person in there, or you've got, you know, a certification person and whatnot, just be mindful that your child welfare folks also are in there, and they may also need to have a POC. So yes, you can share that responsibility.
Also, they wanted to know, is that what you just said there, is that the same for the certification champion?
So for the certification champion, you can have two folks listed, and she will enroll them in that audience and get them squared away with all the certification reports as well. Your POCs also, your LGPOCs also, because we're giving them full access to the Learning Gateway reporting, they would also have access to that. So in theory, you could have six people who have access to your certification reports.
Great. All right. Well, thank you so much, Ashley. That was just such great information. Really appreciate you joining us today and sharing that. And if anybody has any additional questions, actually one just popped up. Ashley, they want to know, for the LGPOC, what if child welfare is not currently in NCFAST?
So if the LGPOC is not, child welfare folks are not in NCFAST, you know, we know we're kind of headed in that direction. What I would say is that you can certainly do four, but just be mindful that as child welfare comes online with NCFAST functionality, that you may have to give up a spot for one of your child welfare folks.
Great. Thank you so much, Ashley. And if people, if people have additional questions, can they just reach out to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Great. Thank you so much, Ashley. Up next on our agenda, we have Richard Stiginga and Tim Egan, who is going to give us an update on CARS replacement. Richard, I'll turn it over to you.
All right. Good morning, everybody. Just the latest monthly update on where we are in the project. As most of you are aware, all of you are aware, we're moving forward with replacement of the current state county administration reimbursement system. Tim will be speaking in just a minute. Our project management lead from Deloitte. Appreciate all the effort that everybody's put into it, all the survey responses, all of the telephone calls and working with our pilot counties. All that has been a tremendous help. You know, we've captured all that information, reviewed it, and then Tim will take it from here just to give an update on where we've been, where we are, and then where we're going next.
Thanks, Richard. And we can jump to the next slide. Before I jump in, I'll echo Richard's sentiment on everyone, appreciate everyone's efforts. You know, the last 2 months or so through the March and April timeframe was the current state analysis as shown on this slide that we just completed here at the end of April. And that involved a lot of stakeholder input from the state perspective, county outreach, both from the statewide survey that was shared and a great response on that, as well as deep dive discussions with the pilot counties. So appreciate everyone on the phone that participated and provided feedback. You know, we've consolidated all of that information now, and you know, looking ahead for the summer is really where we start to formulate what the potential future state may look like across time reporting and also the administrative reporting systems. So maybe just to give you a brief kind of lens of what the next 3 or 4 months look like, developing kind of the to-be state for both business processes as well as systems, and formulating recommendations for the state's consideration, revisiting the feedback that we've collected through all the stakeholder engagement and the current state processes and system analysis that was just completed, and sort of put together considerations over the next, say, 6 weeks. And as we continue to move forward, you know, identifying the system requirements that would be associated with any of those recommendations throughout the summer. And as we start formulating those recommendations, the next piece of the project will really be to do an analysis on a cost-benefit analysis. And this is not only from like an implementation or a procurement standpoint, but also just a general administrative effort, time effort standpoint of, you know, what would be the potential ROI on some of these potential either business or system changes. And then as we kind of wrap it to the end of the summer, that will then start your finalizing recommendations. And there's a few other pieces of kind of phase one of our project in terms of market outreach, and then potential assistance on procurement support and other things of that nature as we get a little bit farther along. So we're right in the weeds, just in formulating initial recommendations kind of right now, and I mean, working really the next 3 to 6 weeks to flush some of that information out and then start tying back to requirements and then really starting to think through the cost benefit analysis. So that's kind of what things look like and where we're at on the project. Just as a reminder, the like phase one runs roughly through the end of this calendar year, kind of depending on kind of the direction that the state ultimately goes and kind of our support, and we'll kind of continue to provide updates as we get farther into this. So we can move to the next slide, and I'll provide a update around some of the feedback that was collected through the interviews for the pilot counties. And I'll also show the survey results on the next slide. One, I would say, you know, the overarching theme is there's a lot of consistency in the results that we collected from the surveys that were consistent with more of the detailed feedback that we collected in the actual kind of one-on-one interviews with the pilot counties. And this is a very high level boil up of the feedback. There was a lot of specific examples shared, and you know, we have some quotes and everything that we've included in our deliverables back to Richard and team. but I want to just share a few here. Won't read all these, but maybe a couple to highlight. Number one is really the effort around the day sheet and time reporting. So a lot of feedback consistently, even on the surveys, around just the administrative effort, both for the fiscal staff, the supervisors, the actual on the ground kind of direct service workers around time reporting. And feedback in a couple different areas, just from the 100% reporting perspective, the complexity of the underlying codes and the code structure, the review time, everything around that. So there was a pretty fairly consistent feedback collected there. I assume that's not necessarily a surprise to most on this call, but that came through loud and clear. So we're working through some ideas of how we can potentially streamline that from our future state. And a few others maybe to highlight, number nine, NC Corrals, a lot of positive feedback. I know that system, for those that have been with the state for a longer, have kind of seen before and after some of the improvements that have been implemented with that system. So a lot of positive feedback around that. We are considering some abilities to maybe expand the capabilities of that system to build on some of the successes that were shared. And then also maybe just to kind of tie into, I'd say number five on training, and also on number 10, succession planning, feedback around just improved communication and training materials on what exists today. And this ties back to my comment around the codes themselves and the time reporting codes, the complexities there. And then also, some of the county feedback, citing that, those that have more experience with the program, kind of leveraging that to make this process be very successful. But some of the concern around succession planning and people in new positions and trying to streamline the process, but also better documentation and training to support future state efforts and documentation. So as things change and turn over, and as the program continues to evolve, that material is available, so people aren't relying on kind of the history of the program and individual knowledge to drive that forward. So those are just a snippet. One other area we did collect feedback, certainly from the state stakeholders that are using some of the internal state systems every day, and we kind of different analyses going on the existing kind of reporting mainframe and NC Corrals that are also part of the assessment here. So that what my takeaway is, there's some opportunity to certainly kind of streamline some processes, try to remove some of this manual intervention. Understand some of these systems have been in place for a significant period of time, so ability maybe introduce some new technology. So that's all on the table here as we work through the next phase of the project. And we can jump to the next slide. This will be just a visual representation of the survey results that we collected. I think as of when we kind of closed the survey at the end of April, we got almost 80 responses, included some of the standalone from a standalone child support from the tribal communities. So a great response rate, a lot of consistency around the processes and the responses with the pilot county feedback, as I mentioned. Maybe just a couple to highlight. I would say in the top right around county sentiment around 100% reporting, there was kind of mixed results. About two-thirds of the counties expressed either neutral to positive support of the 100% time reporting. I think there was back to my the previous slide, the flexibility that provides from a fiscal perspective is seen positively, but certainly the administrative effort is also a consideration that's dampening some of that feedback. And then maybe just to direct you to the middle of the slide around just time the county staff are devoting across the day sheet and Corrals processes. I'll let everyone absorb some of this information, but on average, so for example, the employees completing day sheets, roughly half or more of the counties are highlighting at least 10 to 20 minutes a day to complete those sheets. Then there's the additional time for supervisors approving that are a little bit less of an administrative effort than the staff completing the day sheets, and then the staff uploading to SIS, a little bit less effort on average. But you know, you start to quantify and extrapolate this statewide, you know, on average, say 10 to 20 minutes a day across every county, across every individual, you know, it does become, you know, a fairly administrative effort involved. And again, we had some great direct feedback provided through the survey as well. You know, the counties believe that the accuracy of the day sheets is very strong, very accurate. You're leveraging this information to predict your and forecast your budget and funding well. But again, like kind of some of the feedback has been just on the complexity of the process. Not as much with like the upload or the maintenance with Corels or SIS per se, but a lot of just the effort around the reporting and complexity of the reporting with you know, the dynamic nature of the program. And I certainly wish these slides will be shared so you can digest this a little further, but that's had the high level overview. And then lastly, just want to close with kind of what we're doing in the next 30 to 45 days before we kind of regroup with you all again, if you want to move to the next slide. Okay, so looking ahead the next 30 days, really what we've started to do is take this information in the current state and your feedback and define problem statements and observations across a few different dimensions. There's certainly a people component and the time effort, the processes and the technology dimensions, and we're facilitating additional discussions with the state to review these statements and start formulating potential recommendations. And in addition to that, we're leveraging some more data analysis to analyze, particularly the time reporting options in some modeling and data simulations, just to understand if you were to move away from 100% reporting to some higher level aggregation or anything like that, like how would the certain time redistribution potentially impact funding, impact time allocations across counties or programs? For example, there's also a fair amount of usage of the general administration time. If there's an opportunity to kind of revisit how that time's being coded, how is that being distributed today and allocated? So we're informing some of these recommendations with some, you know, financial analysis on the day sheet and minute data that's being collected today. And you know, really the goal by mid-June is to have some high-level recommendations that we have kind of formulated with DHHS on kind of where, from a priority standpoint, they would like to focus. You know, as I mentioned, you know, some of those, the feedback areas are more significant than others. You know, some items such as training and communications, you know, might be a little bit more of a low-hanging fruit opportunity. Certainly something involved with time reporting or system and replacement is a much more material effort. So we're going to kind of work through the priority and timing, and then we'll you know, package that together, starting to define what those to-be processes and process flows and system requirements would entail around these recommendations. And then at that point, kind of by mid-June, if we come back to this group, we'll be right about when we commence some of the cost-benefit analysis for those recommendations with the goal of having that information come back, you know, by the August timeline to start trimming this down to a much more subset of recommendations that the state can you know, consider moving forward with. So that's where we're at. Again, appreciate everyone's support and feedback collected. You know, as we get a little bit deeper into this, you know, we'll work with Richard and others to you know, continue to share this information on this forum or other forums with you as we get further along. So I'll stop there, Richard. Anything else you'd like to add, or if there's any questions we want to take quick?
No, that's good, Tim. Thanks for that presentation. I think it does a good job capturing the effort, you know, at a high level, and all the processes we've gone through gives counties a sense of where we're going and already starting to formulate potentially some of our options out there.
All right, thank you.
Okay, so Thank you, Tim, and thank you, Richard, for that update on the CARS system. Just had one question that came in. What does CARS stand for? So that is the County Administration Replacement System is what that stands for. And thank you both for giving us reimbursement. Sorry. Say that one more time, Richard, then for everybody to hear it the same.
It is. It's county-specific system, right, for county DSSs. It is the county administration reimbursement system. Front-facing, you know, counties certainly recognize NC Corals. They recognize, you know, day sheet upload processes. CARS is the back-end system that really manages and runs and pulls all that together, calculates the cost, you know, calculates the reimbursement to counties, feeds federal reporting and federal claiming from the state end. That's what that system is. And that backbone system is what needs to be replaced and what we're looking at replacing here.
Great. Thank you for that clarification, Richard. Appreciate you. Okay, so moving on, the last item on our agenda is a very quick update on the child support system modernization. And so, Jay, if we can move forward just two slides. So I believe last month I announced that the vendor to do planning for the system modernization had been selected. New South Technologies started in April and has really hit the ground running. Currently, they are going through sessions to identify our as is. In other words, what is our system currently do so that we have a really great idea of knowing what we would like a new system to do, either maintain some of the current processes or replace them. We have had focus groups that have included child support experts from counties who have been actively participating in these sessions, and a new group of county staff and focus groups coming up next month as we start talking about our 2B. We also have set up some surveys where counties can give feedback on what they would like to see in a new system. The link here is on this slide. And as I mentioned before, we will be sending a copy of this PowerPoint out immediately following this session, so you have that link. So far, we've had about 400 child support staff, focus group members, and attorneys who have provided us feedback. And all of that feedback is being compiled by New South Technologies to help us inform what is the next steps for getting our, for determining what type of system we want. So next steps then would be identifying the 2B for a new system and conducting a market analysis to see what is out there that would effectively work to replace our current ACTS system with a new modern system. So there's a lot of work going on right now in the child support world. And so stay tuned. You will be asked for your feedback along this planning phase so that we can move forward with the best possible information we needed for our next step of getting what we want. Do see a couple of questions in the chat, and one of them is about this recorded presentation. This presentation is being recorded and will be posted as soon as possible so that you can have a copy of this recording along with the PowerPoint. So let me see if there are just any other questions that we can answer in the last couple of minutes. Richard, two for you. We have a couple minutes, so I'll ask. One question was, are you looking or getting information from other states and how they report? And this is talking about the CAR system, considering North Carolina is the only one using day sheet programs.
Yes, we are certainly looking at that.
Great. And then the second question was, how do counties sign up? Oh, never mind. This is how do counties sign up new staff to receive DSS terminal messages? The link in the manual does not work. Sorry, Bobby, I didn't read all of that before I started reading that. I will send you the link for how you can get people signed up for DSS terminal messages following this call. And I don't see any other questions. So I just want to say thank you all for taking the time to be with us. I hope that you all have an amazing rest of your day and a great rest of the week. Please continue all the great work and take care of yourselves. Bye, everyone.